Church Alive, welcome to our online service. If you're a newcomer, we are so glad you joined us. We would love to connect with you, so text CA New Here to 555-888. Many of us cannot be together in person, so I want to encourage you with the Apostle Paul's words in Hebrews 10. We must hold tightly to the faith that we say is ours. After all, we can trust the one who made the agreement with us. Don't allow fear to rule today, but instead, choose faith. Don't stop being the hands and feet of Jesus, and don't neglect the power of coming together with other believers. Now, let's press in and touch the heart of God this morning through worship. So wherever you are, may your hope and faith rise as you encounter God today.
Thank you for being unstoppable. Come on, come on, come on. Put those hands together, come on, come on, put a smile on your face this morning. Come on, hey. Heaven thundered and the world was born. Life begins and ends in the dust you form.
Nothing shall be impossible. Greater is He living in me than he who's in the world. Mighty to save, stronger than the Savior of the world. Come on. There's fear in the eyes of the enemy, for the battle belongs to the Lord. Declare that, yes. There's refuge and hope for the weary, for the battle belongs to the Lord. And greater is He
we
Scripture teaches that giving is an expression of our worship. Thank you, Church Alive, for your faithfulness in giving. We offer 5 ways to give and want to encourage you to stay faithful in your giving. Deuteronomy 28 says, "If you fully obey the Lord your God and carefully follow all of His commands I give you today, the Lord your God will set you high above all the nations of the earth. All these blessings will come on you and accompany you if you obey the Lord your God. You will be blessed in the city and blessed in the country. The fruit of your womb will be blessed, and the crops of your land, and the young of your livestock, the calves of your herds and the lambs of your flocks, your basket and your kneading trough will be blessed. You will be blessed when you come in and blessed when you go out. The Lord will send a blessing on your barns and on everything you put your hands to. The Lord your God will bless you in the land He is giving you." God loves to bless His people. Again, the opportunities to give are in person, mail, app, online, or by text. Now, join us for an encouraging message.
Good morning, Church Alive. I'm so glad that you're joining us today, online, whether you're at home or maybe you're watching this somewhere else. Maybe it's Sunday morning, maybe it's not, but we're so glad that you're tuning in today and joining us. I want to begin today by telling you a little parable, a story. It's a man who's really just down and out on his luck. And he's lost his job. His family is literally on the verge of starving. He's trying to just find and gather, okay, what can I do to gather the last meal for my family to enjoy? In desperation, he begins to think and begins to wander and begins to do all these different speculations. And finally, he decides, I've got a rifle and I've got 3 bullets. And so he decides to go hunting to provide food for his family. One last meal. So as he's making his way through the woods down the path, he spots a rabbit. He takes aim at the rabbit. He fires and he misses. The rabbit runs away and finds safety in the cover of the bush. So the man continues down the path. Next, he sees a squirrel in the treetops. He takes aim and he fires, misses the squirrel. In frustration, blaming himself, now blaming the squirrel, that stupid squirrel, he pushes forward and moves on. Down the path, he comes across and looks up and sees a turkey perching in a tree. He begins to lift the rifle to take aim. But then all of a sudden, at the corner of his eye, he sees a deer standing in the distance. And then he hears a voice say to him, it says to him, "Pray first, aim high, stay focused." He looks back at the deer, looks at the turkey. The next thing he knows, he looks down and between his legs is a rattlesnake about to bite him. So he turns the rifle down to the snake, like most anyone would do, about ready to take fire. And then he hears the voice again. "Pray first. Aim high. Stay focused." The man's trying to rationalize this in his head. This deer could feed my family. This turkey could feed my family. But the deer would last longer. But here's a snake about to try to end my life. But the man listens to the voice. He aims high. He prays. He focuses, and then he fires. The rifle catapults the bullet. That bullet hits that turkey, deflects from a bone in the turkey, hits the deer, and the man, with the firing of the shot, loses his balance. And on his way down, falling into a pond, his heel crushes the head of the snake. As the man rises out of the pond to see what's all occurred, his pockets are full of fish. He sees the deer laying. He sees the turkey. But most importantly, he looks down and at his feet is the enemy, his snake, this snake laying dead at his feet. And this parable illustrates that it pays to discern God's voice. Follow His Word and stay focused on Him. Church, I want to tell you today, we have many options, don't we? And there are many opinions, isn't there? And there are definitely many storms. But what we need today, in this moment, in this season, is a fresh revelation. Today I want to talk to you about a fresh revelation. Because why is a fresh revelation important? Why is it so vital to our lives right now, today? A fresh revelation from the Lord puts things back into the right focus. You see, focus is important because whatever has your focus, it has your heart. Focus is important because whatever has your focus has your attention. In fact, whatever has your focus grows and expands or becomes stronger. Think about that for a second. Whatever has your focus determines your direction. Think about that. You can't be walking in a direction and be focused on another and effectively take every step. In fact, whatever has your focus feeds your future. There's a story in Matthew chapter 14, verses 24 through 32. In the New American Standard Version, it reads like this. It says, "But the boat was already a long distance from the land, battered by the waves, for the wind was contrary, and it was the fourth watch of the night. He came to them." Who's He? Jesus. I want you to capture this moment. They're a long distance from the shore, meaning, really at this point, there's no turning back. They've got to keep going forward. They were battered by the waves. Where do the waves come from? From the wind. So now you've got waves, wind, and there's no turning back. And now, on top of that, it's the fourth watch of the night. What is the fourth watch of the night? The fourth watch of the night is the darkest part of the night. And so here comes Jesus, Scripture says, walking on the sea. Verse 26 says, "When the disciples saw Him walking on the sea," listen to the word, "they were terrified and said, 'It's a ghost.' And they cried out in fear. But immediately Jesus spoke to them, saying, 'Take courage, it is I. Do not be afraid.'" Verse 28 says, "Peter said to Him, 'Lord, if it is You, command me to come to You on the water.' And He said," Jesus said, "'Come.' And Peter got out of the boat and walked on the water and came toward Jesus. But seeing the wind, he became frightened and he began to sink. He cried out, 'Lord, save me.' And immediately," Scripture says, "Jesus stretched out His hand and took hold of him and said to him, 'You of little faith, why did you doubt?'" Let me give you a little background of this story in Matthew chapter 14, beginning in verse 24. Prior to this story that we just read, it comes on the heels of a great loss and a great exhaustion. What do I mean? Jesus is dealing with the recent execution of His cousin, John the Baptist, who was beheaded for his truth-telling, for His prophecy-proclaiming, and for His belief in Jesus Christ. So, personally, Jesus is carrying this as a leader, leading this movement, leading this change, this encounter, this revolution in this society where religion had become the God instead of a relationship with Jesus. And so He's carrying this weight of his own cousin who's now beheaded. And then He's also exhausted because He just experienced at that time His largest catering event. In fact, Scripture defines it as describing it as He fed 5,000 men, which is in roughly is about 15 to 20,000 people, counting women and children, with only just a few fish and a few loaves of bread. So he's exhausted emotionally, mentally, physically. He's carrying the weight of the loss of his cousin who was executed. So Jesus does what I want us to kind of catch this morning. He begins to lead and direct, but He also, in His humanity, sees that He needs to remove Himself for a time of fresh revelation, a time of realignment. So Jesus initiates a journey to get away. So he tells his disciples, he tells them to go, to get in the boat, to go on over to the other side, and that he would meet them there. Commissioning them to go on ahead on this journey, he removed himself away to seek a fresh revelation, to refocus, to realign, to reconnect again with his Creator, with God, with his Father. And so he removes himself away, but the disciples, halfway, remember, a long way from the shore, find themselves in a storm, tossed by waves and against strong winds. And in the middle of this situation, in the middle of this storm, they began to have fear. They began to worry. And then all of a sudden, they think they see a ghost walking on the water. And they cry out to him. They cry out in terror, Scripture says, and shout, "It's a ghost." And Scripture goes on to say, they cried out in fear. Now, Jesus comes near them and he says he immediately spoke to them saying, "Take courage, it is I." Now, I don't know about you, but if that was me, I'd be saying, "Let me see some identification, come a little bit closer," getting out my iPhone light, trying to see exactly who is it, who it is I, who is I, right? Who are you? But to these men, the recognition of those words and the sound of that voice emphasize who was walking on that water to them. But I want to take a few observations from this story as Jesus approached them in this situation. Number one, Jesus came at their darkest moment. Remember, Scripture said that while they were being tossed by the waves and against the winds in this moment of fear, it was during the fourth watch of the night. The fourth watch of the night is the darkest night. It's usually between just before dawn, between 3 a.m. and 6 a.m. Now, some of you early birds say, "Well, it's light around 5 a.m. or whatever in the morning." Whatever the case, depends on where you're at, and you may not have ever been where the disciples were at that time. But it was the darkest part of the night. And if you've ever been awake without a full moon in that part of the night, it is the darkest part of the night. But the good news about the darkest part of the night is that it is on the heels before the break of day, before light begins to shine again. And so what I love about this moment is Jesus came at their darkest moment. And if you read the Scripture, it says that in the middle of their storm, Jesus spoke. When they were crying out, terrified, and they cried out in fear, Scripture says, Jesus spoke, and I love the word in the New American Standard Version, immediately. They cried out in fear, but immediately Jesus spoke. Wherever you are, whatever you're doing, I want you to write this down, because you and I, we face storms just like these disciples did. We encounter crisis just like they did. We fight battles and fight wars and even raise fears in our own life just like they did. Sometimes it's hard for us to relate to the humanity of these individuals, but I want to catch and put it in perspective of what these men were facing and relate it to how you and I are walking out. Because here's the deal. You and I need to learn to distinguish His whisper over the waves. You see, when they heard His voice, they identified, they knew who He was. The disciples were lost in the smaller narrative, and then Jesus showed up. Church, don't get lost in a smaller narrative based on what you see, hear, feel, and miss the miracle of the moment. I want to challenge you to go back to the Scripture that I just read in Matthew chapter 14, verses 24 through 32. And I want to encourage you to read it. And I want you to identify the humanity of these men, their senses, the emotions, the feelings that they express, and even the mind, the wrestling in their mind that they had to engage in this moment. You can relate to that. I know I can relate to that. But Jesus came in their darkest moment. But number two, Jesus also came standing on the storm. You see, Jesus not only responds at their darkest hour, but He is actually standing on the very thing that holds them hostage. I want you to catch this. In verse 28, Peter said to Jesus, Lord, Lord, I know it's you. Lord, without a shadow of a doubt, it's you. No, he didn't say that, right? I got it right the first time. Peter said, Lord, if. Underline that word in your Bible. Write it down in your notes. Verse 28. Lord, if it's you, command me to come on the water. Listen to me today. There were 11 men who remained in that boat. One who stepped out. Which one do you relate with the most right now? Right now, in the middle of your situation, who do you relate with the most? The 11 who stayed in the boat or the one who stepped out? See, I love the word if. You know why I love it? I love the word if because you see the humanity of Peter when his faith is wrestling against his fear. Now don't stand before me and tell me you've never been fearful. Don't come to me and say I've never endured something difficult. I've never met a challenge that pressed against my faith. Or don't come to me and even say those things, but because we've all in our humanity have wrestled against things and against different things that come against us or different situations that arise. But we've got to remember that in our darkest moment, Jesus is there. We've got to remember that even in those darkest moments, in the biggest storms of our life, that Jesus is coming. He's already present. He has never left. That he's literally there. And just like with the disciples, Jesus came standing on the storm. He was there in their midst. In the immediacy, he was present. And number three, when the disciples cry out in fear, Jesus responded by revealing who he was. He cried out. When they cried out, he responded and revealed who he was. Verse 27 says, take courage. It is I. Do not be afraid. You see, the words, it is I, is actually, in the original language, the words, I am. If you've ever read the Old Testament, you maybe have come across those words where God refers to himself as I am. You see, these Hebrew boys recognized who I am was. They had studied. They knew the Torah and who I am was. They were familiar. They had been in the presence of Jesus and they were familiar with the I am. And I want you to catch this, that Jesus had every resource at his disposal and the storm was under his feet. You see, we're not different from the disciples. We're not different from them. A lot of times it's hard for us to put our situations and our crises in our surroundings into their settings. But when we're in a storm, we're just like them. What we want is an instant solution. We want an instant solution, don't we? But what we need is a fresh revelation. We need a fresh revelation. We need to know who is with us. You see, when Peter put his focus on Jesus, when he kept his focus on Jesus, he started moving closer to Jesus. His step, with every step, took him closer to Jesus. Remember, there were 11 who stayed back in the boat. They took him closer. In fact, what I would say is that his feet followed his faith. When he kept his focus on Jesus, he became like Jesus, doing what Jesus did. In other words, you could say, that's what faith does, right? Faith raises you above the waves that are pressing against your life. When Peter put his focus on Jesus, his circumstances, the storm, I want you to catch this, because some of us need to hear this morning. His circumstances, the storm, had no power over him. What do you mean? They still had relevance. Don't get me wrong. I'm not preaching that pie in the sky stuff. His storm still had relevance. The waves were still present. We obviously can see that when we read. The wind was still present. And there were still 11 men sitting fearful, perhaps, in the boat. But although the storm had relevance, it was just as real as it was when he was sitting in the boat, the storm no longer held authority. Don't miss this. Somebody right now better be off their couch shouting hallelujah, because you got stuck to that couch now, and at this moment, your situation has, you have given more authority and give you, yes, it's real. Yes, it's definitely absolute, maybe in your perspective, that it seems hopeless. It seems endless. There's no end in sight. But you better get off your couch right now and begin to declare, say, take back the authority that you've given away to the storm that is surrounding your life, surrounding your marriage, surrounding your job, surrounding your future. You better get off your couch right now and take back that authority that you have given, even though the relevance of the storm is absolutely around you. Get that authority back, because that's what Peter had to do when he put his focus back on the Lord. You see, when he kept his focus on the Lord, he was moving in a new direction, doing things he had never done. He was no longer stuck or sinking. But again, in our humanity, when Peter took his focus off of Jesus, the same elements that surrounded him, that relevance I've talked about, the same elements that were subject to him a few steps prior now ruled him. He was becoming more distant. As Jesus was above, he was below, sinking. You see, his faith was replaced by fear. The authority was now surrendered back to the storm. His fear was now in submission to the storm and not the Savior. A question I want you to ask yourselves today. I want you to write this question down. A question I want you to ask yourself is that, where in your life have you experienced sinking? Where in your life have you experienced sinking? I've experienced some sinking in different areas of my life. Maybe it's in the areas of finances. Maybe it's physically in your body. Maybe it's mentally. Maybe the greatest area of sinking that you've experienced is in your mind. Maybe it's in your spiritual well-being. Maybe it's in your relationships. Perhaps your employment. Maybe in parenting. Maybe it's in your self-worth. Or perhaps it's in your marriage. Where have you in your life experienced sinking? There's a man by the name of Henry Cloud. He's a clinical psychologist, a believer, and a leadership coach. He's a world-renowned clinical psychologist. And he teaches something called the three P's. And he describes these three P's as the actions that happen when an individual begins to process mentally in their mind when they begin to lose control or when they feel like a situation is out of control. And as I read the three P's, I immediately reflected back to times when I felt these ways, like things were out of control, things weren't going good, things seemed hopeless, things like that. And I began to take myself through these steps. The first one is this. The first one, P, is this: personal. He says that the first step of a person's process, mental process, when they lose control, because you see, here's the deal. You got to keep this in mind. Let me put this in perspective. You see, we serve an omnipotent God. What does that mean? An all-powerful God. But this God created you and I, right? He created you and I. But He didn't create you and I, Adam and Eve, from the beginning as omnipotent. He created them as potent. Now, yes, He gave them dominion and authority over things. But remember the snake who came and slithered around and said, "Don't you want to be like God?" He tried to parallel and say, "Don't you want to have the narrator's authority? Don't you want to have that control?" And they fell, right? They fell. Well, that's like you and I. We're still in our humanity. We're potent. We're not omnipotent. We're not. We have power, but we only have the power within us called self-control. That's what He's given us. That's the control that He's given us to lead our life. One of the examples that Henry Cloud gives is, he says, a lot of times we think we're driving the car. We're driving a car. We're going somewhere. You're not going somewhere. You're not driving a car. You're holding the steering wheel and you're operating. That's the control that you have. You're pressing the gas and you start. You're not controlling the situation around you in the process of that journey. You're not controlling the avenue. But a lot of times when things come against us, the first thing that we process in our mind is the personal. He describes the first P as this. We begin to feel bad. We begin to say, I can't do this. We begin to say, I'm not good at this. If I only have this, we begin to personalize it. We begin to beat ourselves up. Put it in Peter's perspective. You see, sinking in his situation reduced visibility. But what you got to do in the middle of this moment, as soon as you begin to personalize it and recognize that's what I'm doing, that's what I'm doing, you need to embrace, you need a fresh revelation of God's truth. What is God's truth? Ephesians chapter 2 verse 10 says this in the NIV, "For we are God's handiwork, created in Christ Jesus to do good works, which God prepared for in advance for us to do." What does that mean? That you know what? You're not a screw up. You're not a mess up. You can do this. You will get through this. You don't need anything else outside of following and focusing and staying aimed at God's plan and His purpose for your life. Stay true. Embrace the truth. Receive that fresh revelation. The first step of His P, the first P is personal. The second one is pervasive. What is that? Pervasive is when now it goes from not my fault, it's their fault. It's everybody else's fault. It's not me. It's everyone else. It's the job. It's the team. The team stinks. The leader stinks. If this changed, so it becomes a pervasive thing. So it shifts outward. See, like Paul, let me relate it back to Peter. Sorry, like Peter, we relate it back to him. Sinking reduces perspective. It reduces your visibility, but then it begins to change your perspective. You can't see like you used to see. But you got to, in the middle of this pervasive moment, embrace truth again. Romans chapter 8, verse 28 says, "And we know that in all things God works for the good of those who love Him, who have been called according to His purpose." Embrace that truth. Hold tight to that truth that no matter the storm, no matter the surroundings that you cannot control, God is in control. He will work all things out for the good of those who love Him. The third P is the word permanent. So first it's personal, then it's pervasive, and then it's permanent. So it starts with me. Then it's everybody else's fault, and then it's things will never change. It won't get any better. It's permanent. There's no hope. This is how it's always going to be. This is the new way of doing things. That's the permanent mindset in our mental processes when we begin to lose control of the things around us. In Peter's perspective, sinking presents a bleak narrative. And in that moment, you got to embrace truth. It's not always going to be like that. Remember the time that He brought you through before? Remember what He did then? Remember the stories of faithful friends and family who have endured other hardships and God has saw them through faithfully? You got to embrace truth. What is the truth in this nugget? Revelation chapter 21, verses 4 and 5 says, "He, Jesus, God, will wipe every tear from their eyes. There will be no more death or mourning or crying or pain, for the old order of things has passed away. He who was seated on the throne said, I am making everything new." Then He said, write this down, "for these words are trustworthy and true." Hold on to the truth. It won't always be this way. It won't be, it's not hopeless. It's not lost. It's not everyone else. Embrace a fresh revelation. Pursue it. You see, the response to a loss of control starts with faith over fear. But it's initiated with core disciplines already learned to practice. And you say, oh, okay, Pastor Jimmy, here you go. Here comes the religious. Here comes the spiritual, right? Here it comes. Because these are core disciplines. Praying, fasting, but most importantly, remaining obedient to God's word and the truth. But that's just the disciplines. The other discipline that puts these to action is stepping out in truth. Stepping out onto the truth. Stepping out onto the waters. Embracing the truth. Seeking that fresh revelation and walking in it. What does that look like? Connecting with God and connecting with others. When you study the Apostle Paul's life, you'll find some times in his life where he describes a thorn in his side, and even a moment where he wrestles with depression. And I love what 2 Corinthians, I believe, verse chapter 7 describes. It says that God sent him not a liturgical list of prayers to recite over himself, but God sent him Titus. Who is Titus? A person. To come alongside of him. In fact, Paul describes it to comfort him. To be his helper. You see, wherever you are right now, maybe you're in the boat. I'm not asking you to recite a bunch of liturgical prayers or pray and just fast and be obedient to God's word. I'm asking you to step out. I'm asking you to step out of the boat. And I want you to understand that as you connect with God, you need to connect with other people. Because that's the process that God has put forth for us. In other words, we got to reboot our mind and our vision with fresh revelation. I want to wrap it up with this. You see, in the study of the three P's, Henry Cloud gives a phenomenal illustration how often we get lost when we lose control in the smaller narrative. And he uses the illustration. If you take your most favorite action and adventure movie, maybe it's James Bond, maybe it's Indiana Jones, or maybe it's Jason Bourne, and you're watching this movie, you've never seen it before, and if it's well written, then you're lost in the moment when who you think is the hero, when who you think is the person, the good guy, is now trapped. There's only one way in and one way out, and there's seven guys coming in towards him. And if you had, in that moment, took the controller and you hit the pause button when you're streaming it on your TV. Many of your TVs or your streaming services will then pop up the scenes at the bottom of the screen. I love what Henry Cloud, how he puts it in perspective that a lot of times we're like that moment in the movie where we're lost in a smaller narrative. There looks like there's no hope for this guy. He's done. If it's well written, you don't see if the end is in sight for this guy. And you're watching, and sometimes our life relates to that moment. But when we hit pause and we see the scenic view, it's like that moment that we're reminded, wait, the story is not over. But why are we reminded of that? Because when we're able to see the scenic view, we can fast forward to the ending and find the guy maybe floating in a pool, sipping on a drink with the lady. Or with the man, sitting there enjoying victory. What kind of view is that? That's called a larger narrative. You see, a lot of times we get lost in the smaller narrative of our storm. And we lose sight and we forget who controls the larger narrative. Who actually is writing the end of the story. You see, too many times, if you're like me, I want to take the pen and try to write the end of my story. But I've never been given that control or that authority to do so. Sometimes I forget that I'm not the narrator. I'm just the person living out this narrative. You see, we need a fresh revelation, church. We need to understand that we serve a God that controls the larger narrative. We've got to focus on the narrator instead of getting lost in the narrative. Hebrews chapter 12, verses 1 through 2 says, "Therefore, since we are surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses, let us throw off everything that hinders and the sin that so easily entangles, and let us run with perseverance the race marked out for us." Listen to verse 2. fixing our eyes on Jesus, the pioneer and perfecter of our faith. For the joy set before him endured the cross, scorning its shame, and sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. Church, there's good news this morning. There is hope for the distracted. There is faith for the fearful. There is safety for the sinking. There is help for the hurting. In this moment, wherever you are, if you're driving, pull over. If you're sitting in your living room, join your family together. Or kneel by yourself. Close your eyes. And hear these words. Take courage. It is I. Jesus is right there with you. There's no delay. He's not left you. He's not out in left field. He's right there at home, where he's been all along, waiting for you. Right there, immediately, he can and he will reach out and pull you up. Heavenly Father, right now I pray for every person watching today that, Lord, in their life, whatever they've experienced, that they will seek a fresh revelation. That these words today would have encouraged them, challenged them, and God, push them to step out. I pray for those who are watching this who don't know you as their personal Lord and Savior. They have not stepped out in faith and believe that you died for them so that they could walk this journey and know that you're right there with them and that you hold the keys and the plans for the ending. I pray, God, if they're listening today and they don't know you, they'll receive you as their Lord and Savior. They'll text the number on the screen and they'll let us know so that we can partner with them. But also, Lord, I pray for those who are following you and are, Lord God, lost in a smaller narrative. May they remember that, Lord, Father, Lord, we may not know what tomorrow holds, but we know who holds tomorrow. Amen. Thank you, church, for joining us today.
What a great message today. Church Alive, we love you and we're praying for you. Church, let's continue to remain faithful and usher in hope at a time of fear and hopelessness. If you made a decision to accept Christ, text CA SAVED to 555-888. We would love to come alongside of you on this journey, so visit our website to learn more about Church Alive. We're praying for you. Thank you for joining us. We'll see you next time.